Welcome, everybody. This is the podcast where we examine pop culture franchises of the VHS era, improv, new stories, and go on long-winded, self-indulgent, over-important crybaby rants about our favorite movies, TV, and games. I'm Josh.
I'm Mike.
And we were raised by rentals. Mike, I think it's safe to say that the era of cancel culture is over. What do you think?
I hope so.
Yeah, I do too. I feel like we don't hear about it as much as we used to. I feel like the cancel culture trend was another one of the illnesses that spawned in 2020.
Yeah.
Looking back, 2020 was a crazy year, not just for COVID, but I think it's because COVID made everybody crazy and the world went insane. Yeah. And I don't even want to touch on politics, but there's enough insanity outside of that realm.
Abso-fucking-lutely. And I can say it comfortably, working at a hospital, like, holy crap, dude. Just the world was nuts. And it took a while for people to kind of come back. And again, understandably, COVID was hard times. Like, everyone was cooped up. We were all trapped in our houses. Well, not everybody, but, you know, most of us were trapped in our houses. I unfortunately had to keep going to work and being terrified. But it definitely affected everyone mentally. And when all you have is the internet and entertainment to keep you going, you know, you maybe get a little disappointed when one of the people that you seem to be enjoying in a movie or in a, you know, a musician you like or an author you like turns out to be an epic douchebag. You know, sometimes Yes. It's a little hard.
And it seems like there were a lot of people who turned out to be epic douchebags. Like, let's be fair.
Sad but true.
But yeah, it seemed like back in 2020, maybe people just had more time on their hands because we were all stuck at home. But I feel like things that celebrities used to get away with suddenly became completely unacceptable, like overnight. Right. Like, you would hear stories for years about people in Hollywood who were touchy-feely or who had some, you know, really disgusting habits. Or how many rock stars throughout the history of rock and roll have, you know, had 13-year-old girlfriends or married 16-year-olds or, you know.
Right. And like, fucking sang about it.
Yes, exactly. Like, there were songs, you know, in the 80s and 70s and before where, you know, like songs about guys who are pining after girls who are 17 or 16. Like, the fact that jailbait is a term at all that has ever not been disgusting. You know what I mean? Like, that used to be
exactly
like a good thing. Like, it used to be a positive thing. And it's like, why was that ever true? And yet at some point, like, people in the COVID era just decided, you know what, like, we're going to go after all of these people. Like, you know, the tide has turned and the targets are on all their heads and we're going after them. And there's lots of examples, but I feel like, and maybe 2020 isn't even the exact year because I might have like my history mixed up, but I think of people like Kevin Spacey, Bryan Singer, and Joss Whedon, just a couple of, like, you know, Hollywood types that spring to mind, who it seems like it used to be okay to like the work that these people put out, but as soon as their evils were exposed and they were canceled off the face of the earth, suddenly you can't watch their movies anymore.
Yes. And that's the thing, like, just to kind of like solidify this thought is we always knew that this type of shit was happening. In fact, something I constantly talk about with one of my other friends when we are gaming, we're talking about like how it, like, it's very disappointing. Like, for example, Neil Gaiman, we all heard about with Neil Gaiman. It's very disappointing, but you don't have to suddenly hate the stuff that you used to love that impacted your life that they've created. So for example, like, I fucking love Buffy the Vampire Slayer. It sucks that Joss Whedon turned out to be what he is. It really fucking sucks. Is that going to take away the teen years of watching Buffy and obsessively loving that show? No, of course. I loved that show for a reason. Does it suck that he was being a total prick to people behind the scenes? Abso-fucking-lutely. He's been called out for it as well. He should have been called out for it. It is an acceptable behavior. But to then take anyone who is still a fan of that work and try to call them out in the same regard, that's kind of where I have a problem, where it's like, oh, wait, you still like Buffy the Vampire Slayer? Well, you're now a horrible person because Joss Whedon is a horrible person. Fuck that shit. That shit needs to stop. That's where I get pissed off.
Yeah, yeah, I agree. And this is a follow-up to what's now turned into a whole series of Rental Rant episodes where, you know, we're talking about toxic fandom, and we've talked about the types of fans who, you know, want to gatekeep. They want to keep you out of their fandom. The kind of fans right. who, you know, when even when you're in their fandom, they want to judge you for not, you know, being enough of a fan or a good enough mm-hmm. fan. Like, you're not elite like them. Or, you know, when we talked about, you know, the kind of fans who look down on other fans who aren't like them because, you know, they're racist or misogynist or whatever. Like, we've gone through all of these topics, and I think this is another flavor of that, because, you know, what you're talking about here is now we're judging other fans of something for liking it at all.
Right, you know? Exactly.
And not even because, oh, you're not a good enough fan, or, like, you know, name three songs or, you know, whatever. It's like, no, now right. we're just saying, like, oh, because you like that property, you are evil. You know, right. like, you, and because that property is associated with a creator who is tainted in some way, now everything about that property becomes tainted. And yeah, I find it just incredibly sad.
Yeah. Well, you know what it smacks of to me, and maybe not everybody had this experience growing up, but I feel like a lot of fellow nerds have experienced this at some point in their lives, where, like, as a kid, I often got mocked for, you know, like, I liked comic books, okay, especially in middle school and high school. I got made fun of for it. And it was like, ugh, you're a fucking nerd. Like, you like comic books? Ha! Like, that's just, it was constantly made fun. Hell, into my early adulthood, I got made mm-hmm. fun of for it. So, but then suddenly comic books were cool again. And comic books were awesome. And everybody loved comic books. And it was like, oh, I fucking love this. And I love, you know, and they were all into comic books. But I already had that experience of, fuck you, you stupid nerd. How dare you like something so nerdy? But now those same people that were doing that are also being like, fuck you, you stupid nerd. How dare you like that thing, because that proper or that person that created that property sucks. So it's right back to that feeling outcast and picked on and being, you know, labeled the nerd, like, in high school. But now it's from this place of superiority. Like, I have purged this person from my liking because they turned out to be bad. You didn't do the same, therefore you are also bad. And it's like, can we just stop with that shit? Can we just yeah. stop judging everybody based on what they like?
Yeah, especially when it's so inconsistent. And that's why it is a toxicity in the fandom, and not just a, like, human principle that we should all follow now that we've evolved, you know? And mm-hmm. and what I mean by that is, like, there used to be a time in American society when it was completely acceptable to be racist, but we evolved right. as a society, and now people realize, oh, that's horrible. And so every time somebody is outed as a racist, the only people who support them are other racists who out themselves as racists by supporting the first racist. But, like, as a society, everybody is against that. Everybody has accepted that, okay, as a concept, this is not a thing that we're down for. And people who don't agree with us, people who, like, stick to the old ways, you know, they're not as evolved, right? They're like, right. you know, and, like, it's like, they're not with us. Like, they're not with us, you know? Like,
you can't sit with us.
Exactly. But then you look at this concept of, you know, this cancellation concept, and not just canceling people, but to, you know, specifically to the point of, because somebody becomes canceled, by which we mean, like, they're exposed as being, like, a shitty person who's done disgusting or evil things or has an opinion that is just reprehensible, then the thing that they're associated with, it gets tainted along with them. But as a society, we have not all agreed that, oh, shitty person equals shitty property, because there are so many exceptions to that rule. I think one of the biggest examples of the topic at hand is J.K. Rowling with mm-hmm. Harry Potter, where, because J.K. Rowling has come out with opinions that fly in the face of what a lot of society nowadays, you know, is evolving towards, right? Which is acceptance mm-hmm. of transgender norms and, you know, just a different understanding of how gender and sexuality operate within the human species. But because she's coming out in opposition of that, what is perceived as an evolution of our human understanding of, you know, of our humanity, now she's a terrible person. So all of Harry Potter is terrible. And right. like my kid, who, you know, is queer, who used to be a huge Harry Potter fan, dressed up as Harry Potter characters on more than one Halloween, had Harry Potter stuff all over their bedroom. Now, every time we're at a store and I'm like, oh, cool, like, look at this, like, you know, neat Gryffindor mug. It's just, ugh, gross. And it's like, it's ruined, completely yeah. ruined for them. And I think a lot of people kind of feel the same way. Mm-hmm. But then you look at, we mentioned some of these examples of, like, you know, celebrities or singers or whatever. And there are so many other people out there who are doing so many, like, horrible douchebag things. Like, how is it that actors are still getting away with having, like, 15-year-old girlfriends? And, like, people don't seem to care about that. Like,
right.
that's what I mean about this being so inconsistent. As a society, we haven't agreed that, like, you know, we need to evolve. We've only agreed that, well, we hate this particular celebrity right now today and everything about them. Oh, but we still love that guy, you know?
Mm-hmm. Well, and that's the thing. Like, I definitely don't want to get political, but this is something you see in politics all the time where it's like, you know, if, for example, if you are not enjoying either side of the political spectrum and are upset about something, some people will take that as, wait, you don't like the side that I'm for? You're for the other side. And it's like, well no, I don't like them. I'm just saying I have this question here about this. This bothers me too. But how dare you question that? It's like, that shit is, it's old, man. Like, can we just stop the constant, like, finger pointing at everybody about everything? It's, I don't know. That really frustrates me. I recently had a conversation at work where, again, not to get political, but they were talking about politics. And I basically said my piece of, well, I'm not really happy either way. Like, it's just, it sucks with certain things that are going on in this country, especially when it comes to healthcare. And it's like, oh, how dare you question it? It's like, wait, no, I'm not. It's like you got to keep your mouth shut unless you want to be labeled a bigot. It's horrible. Yeah,
it is. And it's because we as a human animal, I think, are so quick to jump to this concept of, you know, it's black or white. If you're not for us, you're against us. Like, this, yes. this whole concept, like there cannot be any gray area. It's either you're for us or you're against us. You know, you're good or you're bad. You're left or you're right. You're blue, you're red, whatever it is. And it's like, mm-hmm. every time somebody tries to express an opinion of that, that falls somewhere in the middle, like, somehow that's worse. And I don't understand right. how that is. It's like, you know, a person who is blue politically can think that people who are red politically are stupid and misguided and, you know, evil. But yet, if you say, well, I'm kind of purple, I'm kind of in the middle, and it's like, well, fucking shit, I'll get off the pot. And somehow that's worse, you know?
Right. Like, exactly.
Because it's like this all or nothing thing where if you are associated with the enemy, then you're the enemy and everything about you is the enemy. Just like with these pop culture concepts where it's like, you know, because somebody like, you know, Neil Gaiman does something or is revealed to have done something that looks really bad in the public eye, that really paints him as having done some shitty stuff in the past, suddenly I can't like Sandman anymore, you know?
And right.
Like, and that's some bullshit.
I feel like this idea of one way or the other, not only is it dangerous in, you know, in life in general, but it's dangerous for creativity. It's dangerous all the way around because it starts to stop conversation. You stop talking about things. You stop learning. Like, because mm-hmm. I'll tell you one thing. One of the ways that I've learned my entire life is by talking to people who disagree with me, because it's opened my eyes to be like, well, shit, well, why do they think that way? Like, especially when it comes to entertainment, like, there's been so many times where I'm like, ah, you know what? I don't like rom-coms. Fucking rom-coms are stupid. I don't like it. And then I would talk to you, who, again, traditionally have liked several rom-coms.
Yeah.
'Cause you you and Christina used to go to them all the time, and you would tell me about them, and I'd be like, that sounds so fucking stupid. Why do you like this? And then I would watch them and be like, oh, shit. I was wrong. I should have been watching some of these. These are actually good movies. But you have to open yourself up a little bit sometimes when you I'm not saying agree with everybody. I'm just saying hear people out. Make an informed decision about stuff. So, like, with the Harry Potter thing, going back to that, like, I was heartbroken when I heard some of the stuff that Rowling was saying. I was like, this sucks. I always looked up to her as an author. I always thought she was a really cool creative person. And it was really sad for me to see her come out as the villain. Like, there's that old adage of you either die the hero or, you know, live long enough to see yourself become the villain. And that's kind of like, I feel like that happens to a lot of celebrities. But like, I was really heartbroken when that came out. It didn't stop the enjoyment that I had for the property, though. I have a ton of great memories attached to when those books were coming out. Those books were coming out at a very important time in my life, and it was very cool for me to be able to discuss those books with my friends, to be able to guess like what's going to happen next. Like, I have so many great memories tied to that. I refuse to trash that part of my life because the person turned out not to be a good person. I would hazard a guess as 90% of the entertainment we consume had at some point someone who had bad intent involved in it. You know, there's so many bad people out there. It's kind of hard not to have that. Look at how many comic artists and comic writers over the years have turned out to be kind of bad people or just dicks. Does that mean that we should stop reading comic books? No. Like, I don't get that. I don't get that mentality of if you don't purge this from your life, then that means you agree with them. And it's like,
yeah,
no, like, hell, I never played the new Harry Potter video game. I was looking so forward to Hogwarts Legacy when I first heard about it. I couldn't wait to play it. But I know so many people that were just furious about this thing was even coming out, that it's almost like the snake eating itself, what I'm going to talk about, because a lot of people were pissed off because of her stance on trans, on everything involving trans people. She's got a very bad take, and a lot of people were pissed off about it. Now, there was, I forget their name, I wish I could remember, but there was a trans streamer, their entire livelihood was streaming video games. They were a Twitch streamer. They were going to play Hogwarts Legacy, but because they dared to play Hogwarts Legacy, all of these people got them shut down. So you care so much about trans rights that you're going to shut down a trans streamer because they dared to involve themselves in something that you disagree with. Like, that to me is the snake eating itself.
Yeah, yeah, I completely agree. And I think it's just ridiculous. It's this concept that, you know, you can't separate the creator from the creation.
Right.
But I think that that's foolish because, of course, you can. Of course, you can separate the creator from the creation. I mean, again, for some reason, music and musicians always seems to get a pass in this regard, right? Because, you know, Phil Spector was an absolute, like, piece of shit of a human being, but nobody is boycotting the hundreds of songs that he produced over the years. Like, people still listen to the music that he recorded over and over and over again. I mean, he defined the sound of the 60s for so many people, and no one is not listening to that music, but, like, the dude was a piece of crap, you know? And it's like, but yet, when, you know, somebody like, I'll use Warren Ellis as an example. I won't get into the accusations that were placed against him a couple of years ago. Quite frankly, it kind of all blew over, but I was kind of caught in the middle of it because, you know, Warren Ellis had some accusations placed against him in like a romantic sort of sense, you know, with some people that he was involved in, and, you know, some women came out and spoke up against him. Again, it all kind of blew over in the long run, and, you know, I never really had a problem with Warren Ellis as a person. I didn't really feel like there was enough there for me to, like, have an opinion on, you know, what was going on. But when it happened, I think it had a lot to do with the time period we were in those 2020s. And it was like suddenly artists that he was working with on comics bailed out of the deal, and comics that, you know, should have come out or should have been relaunched never happened. comic publishers put out statements saying that, you know, they weren't going to publish more comics by him anymore because of accusations. And he got kicked out of some, you know, some things that were coming up. He got kicked out of the Batman 1000, you know, special from DC because of these accusations. And it's like, because some people went on the internet and made accusations against him, suddenly his whole career was destroyed for years. Now, and I'm not saying that the accusations weren't real or there wasn't validity to them. I don't know. I don't know enough about that. But what I do know is that his career was destroyed for at least several years. And at the time, as a huge Warren Ellis fan who bought almost all of his comics and like rant and raved about how great they were and how much I liked him, it was like suddenly I felt like I couldn't, you know, mention it. I had to, like, I was walking on eggshells in my, like, comic book, you know, communities that I belong to online, and everybody was dumping all their Warren Ellis comics 4 years ago. And one of the, you know, online communities where I go to buy and sell comics, it's like everybody was just unloading them for nothing, like, for nothing. And then all the people who were buying them for, like, oh, you want to sell your whole Warren Ellis collection for a buck? Fuck yeah, claim. And then people would dogpile on the person who bought it, saying, like, well, what the fuck? What kind of person are you? And then kick them out of the group because they dared to buy Warren Ellis comics. But it's like, but why does that connection have to exist? Like, I realize that reading the comic might make you think about the creator, or watching the movie might make you think about the creator, but there were other people involved. Let's not forget that I mentioned artists, right, who didn't want to work with him, or publishers who didn't want to work with him. How many movies, how many songs, how many, you know, tours were ruined because people got canceled and suddenly the whole fan base was like, fuck you, and they bailed. Well, then, you know, all those lighting people and grips and producers and, you know, roadies and artists and editors and you name it, they all got fucked out of a job. First of all, that sucks, and that's almost a side rant in and of itself. But I'm like, I can still read Transmetropolitan and not have to think about, like, what Warren Ellis was, you know, doing talking to ladies on the internet. I don't fucking know. I don't care. I'm reading a story about Spider Jerusalem. That's what I'm thinking about while I'm reading that comic. Like, I don't fucking – Warren Ellis's business is not my business, you know?
Right. Well, and you know, it's funny because this actually, I was having flashbacks of a situation that happened to me while you were talking about this. I may have mentioned this on a previous episode, but like a lot of people know that I'm a big World of Warcraft fan. I've played it for years. I've played the game since 2007. Nowhere near as much as I used to, only because, you know, time and life, you know, gets in the way of some things you enjoy. But unfortunately, years ago, it came out that some of the heads at Blizzard Entertainment were really bad people. Again, surprise, surprise, people with a shitload of money and celebrity turned out to be bad people. Shocking, I know. But they...
Ooh, created, clutching my pearls.
I know. They apparently created an environment, especially at some of these like little getaways that they would go to, where there was kind of a pressure for sexual things to happen. And some of the women that worked there were pressured into horrible situations. This should have never happened. This is bad things. This is not something that anyone should ever feel they have the right to do to anyone. Does that mean that it doesn't happen? No, people are still going to be horrible. So we had some big time, you know, big wigs with a lot of fucking money and power wielding that to get sexual favors, very similar to Harvey Weinstein. So we had this unfortunate situation. These heads of Blizzard were not the creators of the current game. They were the guys who basically sat back occasionally, you know, added a little bit of input here and there, maybe a story element or two, but they weren't the developers. They weren't the programmers. They were not the writers, the voice actors, the animators, any of the people that make the fucking game the game that it is. You literally have thousands of people working on this project, and you had about a group of 25 people that were absolute shit stains. So a lot of people boycotted the game. Tons of people boycotted the game. Hell, the people who were making the game protested outside of their own office. They basically had like a strike day where they were just like, fuck you, you pieces of shit. And they were pissed at the people who owned the place. And a lot of those guys got ousted. Some of them unfortunately had golden parachutes because that's the world we live in. And I hate that. But, mm-hmm. you know, they were ousted. They got new hires. They got a bunch of people involved. They have, I forget her name, but a very like high profile woman in like one of the head seats at Blizzard now, who is making a lot of changes and stuff that like making sure this shit does not happen again, which is great. Mm-hmm. But now a lot of people who boycotted when I was still playing, people were like, oh my God, you're playing that? What, you don't care about women? It's like, of course I do. What the fuck kind of accusation is that just because I'm playing a fantasy video game? What the fuck? And I literally had someone who claimed to be a friend flip out on me, tell me I was a piece of shit human being and to fuck off and die. And then they blocked me from that point forward. And the reason they knew I was playing the game is because they were still logged into the Battle.net on Blizzard to see who was playing the fucking game.
Yeah, so they were just hunting. They were hunting for people right. that they could go and attack to like push their opinions on. Because that's what it comes down to is mm-hmm. it's these toxic fans, back to the topic here. And it's not that the creators, that it's okay for them to do these horrible things. Of course it's not.
No.
Like, we're not, nobody is defending these people. What we're saying is like, just because somebody created something doesn't mean that everything that they've ever touched is tainted. This isn't like a communicable disease where everything they touch is infected. Right. Like, you know, people who themselves are assholes can create good art. And I'm sorry, there are lots and lots of examples. That's why I mentioned at the beginning of the episode that it seems like a lot of people in this public creative space, like in Hollywood or whatever, are fucking assholes because mm-hmm. so many musicians, so many actors, so many producers, so many directors have gotten canceled, have gotten outed. Even before cancel culture was a thing, you'd hear these horrible stories. Like people that are held up as heroes in whatever medium they're in, you know, they're dating 13-year-olds. They're, mm-hmm. you know, having people come to their parties so they can, you know, piss on them. They're getting caught with kiddie porn. They're, mm-hmm. like, killing people on purpose or not and, like, going to jail. And it's like, you know, I'm sorry, but, like, Vince Neil shouldn't have gotten away with, like, killing that dude while he was driving drunk. But he sure fucking did. And then people were fans of Motley Crue for decades after, you know. And that's just one example that popped into my head, you know.
Exactly. Well, and it's like it reminds me of like, again, going back to the Harvey Weinstein thing for a minute. When all of that information started coming out, a lot of people were like, well, now I can't watch Miramax movies or now I can't watch Dimension movies. It's like, really? Like,
why not?
All of the other people involved, the writers, the directors, the cast, you can't enjoy their work because the guy who put up the money was a piece of shit human being? Like, most of the people putting up money in Hollywood are probably not good people. Like,
yeah. Well, you know, I mentioned the Phil Spector example because it's a great one that covers a lot of this. Like, Phil, he's literally a murderer. Like, literally right. fucking murdered somebody. And abused his wife and did a bunch of other horrible shit. But you know what else he did? He fucking produced records for, oh, I don't know, the Beatles, the Ramones, the Ronettes, Ike and Tina Turner. I mean, Ike Turner has his own fucking problems, but still, like, you know, like
right.
people still listen to Leonard Cohen. People still listen to Dion. And people sure as fuck still listen to Let It Be by the Beatles. Mm-hmm. But those are all records that were produced and, you know, made possible by a literal murderer. So now what? I can't listen to the Beatles anymore. I can't listen to the Ramones anymore. Nobody is saying that because back to my point where it's like we haven't evolved in a society where we've said, you know, we've drawn this line where racism is bad because of course it is. But we haven't said this concept of, you know, a creator tainting the creation is bad. We haven't evolved to that. And I think the reason we haven't evolved to that is because that's a species that's going to die off. You know what I mean? Like that's an evolutionary line that isn't going anywhere. There's no survival of the fittest for this concept because it's bullshit.
Yeah. 100% agree. And I mean, and that's the thing. We could go on for hours and hours about different examples of this, but I think as much as a mired and murky topic as this can be, I think that the final point on it is just that you can still enjoy something and have it impact your life in a personal way without having to carry that like weight of the horrible thing the creator did. And I always think of something that Matt and Trey from South Park said. They're like, once a piece of art is put out into the world, it no longer belongs to just that creator. Like, sure, the creator made it. They made it. But it doesn't belong to them anymore. It belongs to the people who consume it. Because every way they consume that entertainment is going to be unique to that individual. It's going to impact them at a certain time in their life. Or it's going to impact, like, maybe it really helped them when they were down. Or maybe it just really brings them a shitload of joy and they're happy every time they think about it. Like, you don't own that art anymore. To them, that's their version of your art, and you can't take that away as the creator. And this concept that we want to take that away from people, we want to take that enjoyment away from people because suddenly we can't enjoy this property anymore, is just bullshit. That's literally you just wanting to spread your own misery about the idea, and you're not, it's the misery loves company. I'm not happy about it, so you better not be happy about it. And if you are, I'm going to make sure you're not happy. That's bullshit. Stop doing that to people.
Yeah, exactly. It's entirely toxic. It's, you know, I think what is at the heart of all of these topics that we've touched on in this whole series of fandom and why we keep wanting to talk about it, and it's because it's so frustrating. Mm-hmm. But like, what's at the core of it is people want to control other people. There is something in the human animal brain that wants to exert control over other people. I see it with bullies at school who like want to give my kid a hard time. I see it in fucking religious organizations. You see it in politics. You see it in this kind of shit. It's like everybody thinks that they need to push their opinion onto somebody else because what they think in the front of their brain is, well, I'm right, and so therefore you must be wrong. So I have to tell you that you're wrong and that I'm right. I have to teach you, educate you, and, you know, shove your fucking nose in the dog shit because you suck and I don't. But what's happening in the back of their brain is that this is a bully who is exerting control because they have found some type of weakness that they can exploit and they pounce on it.
Mm-hmm.
And it's all bullshit. It's bullshit in the same way that, like, if my kid gets picked on, you know, for having long hair or long nails or, you know, wearing some clothing that isn't in fashion right now and people want to pick on them, like, and it's like, that is a bullshit thing that's just bullies trying to find something to make fun of you about. And if it isn't one thing, it'll be something else. They make fun of you for your long hair, you cut their hair, they'll make fun of you for something else. You know what I mean? You change that thing, they'll make fun of you for something else. Because it's not the thing that they're accusing you of, it's that they want to exert control over you. That's the only thing that matters. So when you see a bully telling you that you can't do this because I said so, first of all, they've expose themselves as an utter fool, and therefore anything they ever say in the future, you know, you can ignore because they're an idiot, right? Like,
absolutely. It's like
one less person to worry about as far as I'm concerned. But also, you know that, okay, well, this thing that you're so up in arms about, it's really not that big of a deal, because if it was a big deal, it wouldn't be some random bully on the internet. Like, this would be like a movement and evolution of society, like racism, you know, that gets stamped out, or at least we're trying to, like, we're trying to get there. You know what I mean?
Right.
Because that's a worthy cause. But when a whole bunch of people come out of the woodwork and like try to cancel Eminem, oh, honey, please.
Right. Well, and it's like South Park. Again, they're another one very much like Eminem. In fact, I've often said that Eminem is the South Park of the rap world, where South Park has been under fire since they came out, since they initially started. And there's always some group that thinks they need to shut the fuck up. And yet they constantly make more and more and more episodes. And even themselves, they did an entire season where it was hashtag cancel South Park. And they were just like, Matt and Trey were both kind of like, we're kind of done with doing South Park. Like, I know people want us to keep going, but we want to do other stuff. So we're going to try to get canceled. And like, they went really hard trying to get canceled. And you know what happened is people loved it even more because they were sick of the bullshit. People were sick of being told what they could and couldn't like, because X, Y, and Z reasons. And again, it's always that surface level shit. It's never something like, here, this property is just flat out being racist, homophobic, and horrible all the way around. It's never something like that. It's how dare they reference this thing, or how dare they work with this person in the past 20 years ago, you know, like before they knew it was a horrible person. You know what I'm saying? It's always something like that that people get so up in arms about. That's why it's so ridiculous.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Now, I want to wrap this up with, you know, some clarification, because yes, there are shitty people in the world, and not just, you know, assholes, but people who are just horrible human beings who abuse, who abuse other human beings, and, you know, they can fuck right the fuck off and burn in hell forever as far as I'm concerned, but I'm still going to listen to that music, and I'm still going to watch those movies, and I'm still going to read those comic books, you know, and like somebody like, my last example that I'll give is somebody like Gerard Jones. Gerard Jones, if you don't know, is a comic book writer and artist. He's the creator of Prime, which if fans of the 90s might remember that character. But he's been around for a long, long time, you know, right since the 80s. But he's an absolute horrible piece of shit human being. You know, he got caught doing some reprehensible things. You know, underage people were involved. And it's the kind of thing where, like, there's no defending it at all. Mm-hmm. Absolutely no defending it. And he was convicted of it, and he's in jail. But he worked on a lot of comic books that people like, that people still read, that people still enjoy. And there's one particular example where there's an omnibus that's going to be coming out soon, a big giant collection from Marvel and DC doing a joint release for the first time in years, because they hate working with each other, especially now that Disney owns Marvel, because Disney does not work with other companies. They do not do crossovers, but they've agreed to release the amalgam comic books from the 90s, which... Remember those? It was a crossover series where Marvel and DC, when they were not doing good as companies, both of them, they did two big crossovers in the 90s. They did the Age of Amalgam, where they took the characters from both universes and mashed them up, you know, like Captain America and Superman became a character called Super Soldier, right? Like that. Right. And like Batman and Wolverine became Dark Claw. And they had these awesome comics. And they're really hard to find now. The trade paperback collections are like, you know, golden geese trying to find those. But then they also did a crossover series called Marvel versus DC, or was it DC versus Marvel? Maybe it was both. But people actually voted on, like, who would win in a fight, like Punisher versus Batman. You know what I mean? Like, you know, Aquaman versus Namor. Like, and you actually got to vote and, like, get to see that in the comic. But again, they're rare to find now. The collections of them are, you know, impossible. They're like holy grails. And so finally, Marvel and DC get over their nonsense. They're going to put out an omnibus collection of two omnibus collections of both of those stories, and the fans are freaking out. It's finally, yes, because these are genuinely good comics. They sound silly, but they're genuinely great comics by genuinely great creators. Except now you're never going to have a complete collection of those, because they took Gerard Jones comics out of the omnibus. Because he wrote those comics and did these horrible things, now it's like, well, now we can't read Gerard Jones comics anymore. So the comics that he wrote don't get to be included in the omnibus. And I'm just pissed off, because I'm like, yes, he's a piece of shit. He can rot in hell. But why do I have to have an incomplete story? Like, just there's two chapters missing just because this guy wrote them. I don't give a fuck who that guy is. What about the guys who drew those comics and inked those comics and colored those comics? Like, they get screwed over now? Like, fuck that.
Yeah, no, that absolutely fucking drives me crazy. And like I said, it's very similar to the Blizzard thing that I was saying, where it's like you're punishing all the other people that were involved because of the sins of a couple particular people. In this case, because of the sins of one person, you're punishing all the other people. And like that really fucking sucks. Like, especially if it's not like, you know, going into the project, oh, this person is a piece of shit, I'm still going to work with them because I want the money. Like, it's not a situation like that. It's a situation of like, you're entering into a contract, you're working on a project. Years later, you find out, oh shit, that person was horrible. Well, that sucks. You know, but then to have that completely like taken away from you, that also sucks. Like, why should you be punished for the actions of someone else?
I know. You know what it is? It's like, you know, do we sentence every abused wife to prison with the husbands who abused them because they were married to them. They didn't know that they were pieces of shit when they got married. Probably. Right. You know what I mean? Like, it turns out, oh my God, this guy turned out to be a piece of shit and beat me up. And then now they're like, well, you loved him. You had sex with him. I guess fuck you too. And it's like, you see how silly that sounds.
That
right?
sounds ludicrous. Exactly.
It is ludicrous. And that's why this is all stupid. It's toxic. It's garbage. We're throwing it away. We're canceling cancellation.
We're going to cancel culture, damn it.
Exactly. Fuck off. Fuck right the fuck off. Okay.
And I think that, in a nutshell, sums it up. Is sick of this bullshit. Fuck off with that nonsense. Just stop.
Yeah. You know? Just stop. And every time you feel the urge to tell somebody that they shouldn't like something, or they don't like it enough, or they don't belong here, or they don't like it the way that you like it, or they're not the right type of person to like it, just, you know, fuck off, because you are the problem.
Right. And, you know, one final note, and I know we keep saying final notes, but one final note I just want to talk about is, it is okay to not be able to get past something. Like, if something affects you in a way where you're like, I just personally can't enjoy that anymore because it's a bridge too far. Like, maybe something that the person did is too close to something that happened to you. Or maybe it's something that is just, you know, too despicable for you, and you're like, I just can't enjoy it anymore. That's totally fine. It is fine for you to feel that way. What is not fine is for you to tell other people they have to feel that way too. And I'll give the perfect example is the Jeepers Creepers movies. Now, I fucking loved the first Jeepers Creepers movie when it came out. Part two, I felt a little weird about it. I was like, it's a little strange, but whatever. But I didn't know the horrible shit that Victor Salva had done at the time. I knew about, these are good monster movies. And there was a clown movie that he made back in the 80s that I fucking loved called Clown House. It's got, why can't I think of his fucking name? The guy who,
Clown House. I forgot about that. Oh my God. Yeah. It's weird.
Oh, it's going to bug me now. I need to know the actor's name. Plays the one brother, Sam Rockwell. I couldn't think of his fucking name. Sam Rockwell in it. I love
Sam Rockwell.
Right? And I fucking loved this movie as a kid. Again, not knowing how horrible of a person Victor Salva was. So I'm enjoying these movies. I'm loving them as a grown-ass adult liking horror movies. Then I find out not only was Victor Salva a pedophile, but he attacked the kid from Clown House on the set of Clown House. That's why he got arrested. And it was like, oh, fuck. I can no longer watch the movie Clown House, nor can I watch Jeepers Creepers. After kind of realizing what he did, it's like, wait a sec. The creeper is literally your fucking power fantasy. It's this creature that is preying on young men and attacking them and taking what it wants. It's like, oh, God. So for me personally, I can't enjoy those movies anymore. But I've had friends be like, oh, man, did you see the new Jeepers Creepers? Jeepers Creepers Reborn. Like, what did you think? And I'm like, I didn't watch it. Like, well, why not? It's like, for me, I have no interest in those movies. And that's where I leave it at. People have asked me to cover Jeepers Creepers on the Boogeyman's Closet. And again, it's like, I get that you guys still dig that movie. It's totally fine. I'm okay with that. I just personally can't do it. So that's my one veto card for the Boogeyman's Closet. It's like, well, not one, but I have a couple veto cards. But that one is one of the ones where I'm like, I just can't do it because I can't get past what the man did. I ain't going to judge you. If you want to watch the fucking movie, watch it to your heart's content. I'm glad you can still enjoy it. I wish I could. But for me, it's not okay. And that is perfectly fine. So we're not saying you must still enjoy the property because you once did. We're saying you it's fine for not liking it, but you don't have the right to take that enjoyment from somebody else.
Absolutely. Yeah. And I'm really, really glad that you said that, because we're sitting over here on our high horses telling everybody, like, fuck off. You know, we'll do what we want and like what we like. And we're telling other people how they should like stuff. But I think but it's true. And I'm glad that you said that. Just like you said before, how it's important that you need to hear other people's opinions in order to make up your own. You have to.
Yes.
Right? You can't just sit in an echo chamber and make shit up in your own head and then decide that that's how the whole world works. Like, you have to be able to listen to other people. And I hope that people listen to these rants and take something from it. And we're not just preaching to the choir. You know, I hope that people care and want to get to the end of these episodes that we always rant on longer than we expect. But I hope that the lesson here is hitting the listeners the way that it's hitting me right now as I'm sitting here talking about this live with you, where it's like I'm on my high horse saying, like, fuck you, I'll read what I want, watch what I want, listen to what I want, and I don't give a shit, you know, what some guy did in his personal life, none of my business. But at the same time, there are a lot of people who were affected by these absolute, you know, pieces of shit, absolute horrible people. And there were people who were negatively affected by it because they're personally involved or because they had some deep connection to it that they felt like was tainted, and they can't get up, they can't get past it, they can't get over it. Or, you know, and everything is a spectrum. Like, I might be able to read comics by one creator, even though that guy is a douchebag, but, you know, the comics are still good, so I can just separate that in my head. But then I might read another comic and be like, you know, I know what this guy believes, and then I read this comic and I see like echoes of that in the story, and it makes me uncomfortable. But like, that's okay, because again, nothing is black and white, nothing is red and blue, like nothing is one way or the other. Like, there's gray in everything. And I definitely think it's important that, like, you have to just be the fan that you want to be and enjoy the things that you enjoy. But of course, you have to enjoy them. If they make you uncomfortable, fuck them, kick them to the side.
Absolutely.
But, you know what I mean? Like, don't go and tell other people that they have to kick them to the side. But if that's what makes you more comfortable and happier, like, this is all about having fun. Movies and TV and, you know, songs and comics, whatever. It's all supposed to be entertainment. I don't want to shove something down your throat if it makes you uncomfortable. If you feel like you have to shun that because that's keeping your mental health strong, then fuck that. Fuck that thing. Like, and I'll get right behind you. You know what I mean? Like, but it's like, don't let me tell you what to like. Don't tell me what to like, but you gotta look out for your own mental health and your own well-being.
Abso-fucking-lutely. And that, and I really do feel like this will probably be the last in this series of rants, because I feel like we finally kind of capped it with this one, where it's like this is kind of what all that toxicity was leading to, is like we've covered the toxicity in every angle now. And this really is one of those versions of toxicity that I don't feel gets talked about enough, because people are afraid to bring it up. Because if you do bring it up, then you might get labeled as one of the people who agree with this horrible person. It's like, no, stop that. Hear what people have to say. It's important to listen to what people have to say. Listen to what their experiences are. Make your decision based upon that. You know, don't just come in with a preconceived notion of that person likes this thing, then they fit into this category. Just stop doing that to people. We'll never move forward as a species.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly. We need to evolve, you know, and we can. We've shown as a species, as a culture, at least, you know, in the modern American Western culture, we've shown that we can evolve past, you know, horrible things. We can look back at our history and learn from it. And we've shown that that's a real thing. So, you know, we're getting all like maudlin over here. So this is definitely a good place to wrap it up. I definitely think you're right. We put a cap on this topic. I think we came around to something deeper, I think, than what we thought we were going to talk about, you know, almost an hour ago. And I'm happy with that. So I'll just say thanks for listening. I hope that people followed this series and got something out of it. You know, I hope that we're not just preaching to the choir and somebody heard something that will like help you, help your mental health, or help you to be less toxic, you know, like,
yeah,
you know, we don't know who's listening. I know that I have heard and talked and learned things as we've gone through these that make me rethink my stupid, arrogant opinions about things. And, you know, my stupid Facebook memories pop up all the time, and I see dumb opinions I used to post on social media 10, 12, 13 years ago. And I'm glad that I've evolved. And, you know, I hope that we are not in an echo chamber here on this Skype call, you know, just bitching at each other. And, you know, that's my only hope. I hope that somebody is getting something out of these, because, you know, we have fun with this podcast. We get riled up, but, you know, ultimately, you know, we are trying to connect. You know, I'm sitting in my house in Texas, and you're sitting in your house in New York, and people are listening to us, you know, all over the country, all over the world, hopefully. But, you know, we're here to try to connect with each other. And, you know, that's all I can hope for from this podcast.
Absolutely. I couldn't have said it better myself. You know, if you guys are enjoying what we have to say, or, you know, hell, even if you disagree, let us know. We'd like to keep this conversation going. We'd like to, again, like I said, I'm more than fine with talking to people who disagree with me, because that's how I learn. That's how I've grown as a human being. So, and hopefully, you know, there's other people out there that feel that way. So
yeah,
I think this is, as you said, it's a good place to stop. And I this is not the direction I thought this episode was going into, but I actually really enjoyed this conversation.
Yeah, absolutely. I love it when we can find these side paths. You know, we always joke about these like dumb rabbit trails we go down, but you know, sometimes, you know, we find an interesting road. And yeah, at the risk of sounding corny, I feel like we found something profound, or at least I feel like I am thinking more deeply about the topic than the, like, you know, stupid soundbite that we started with, you know, talking about cancel culture, you know, and I'm happy we got here. So anyway, we'll just go ahead and wrap it up then. And, you know, I won't go through all the social medias and all our typical outro. And I honestly, at this point, it seems kind of silly to do so, you know, but obviously, there's lots of other projects involved in the Red Pantheon. You can go check those out, redpantheon.com. Go listen to some of our other episodes. Listen to all the rental rants. We have the whole series about toxic fandom. Listen to our Super Gushers, where we talk about happy things, positive things. And the next time that we do an episode that isn't an improv, we're going to do another Super Gushers episode. We're going to talk about something fun and positive, and we're going to like rant and rave about how awesome something is.
Oh, I can't wait.
We do the next one. We got spooky season coming up. The next couple episodes are going to be hopefully fun, hopefully a little scary, hopefully wild and crazy. And I know I'm looking forward to the rest of the year. So I'll just wrap it up right there. Mike, you got any last words?
Just the return of the Boogeyman's Closet is imminent. I don't know exactly how it is going to come back. We're currently restructuring a few things. I got some ideas, but that's coming back soon. Definitely, like you said, check out Red Pantheon. There's a ton of great podcasts on that network. It's just a lot of cool people doing cool stuff. So check that out. And I can't wait for spoopy season, man. I got a lot of fun stuff planned.
Yeah, it's going to be awesome. It's going to be so much fun. We have so many great episodes coming out that I'm getting really excited just thinking about it. The ones we've already recorded, oh, I wish we could like talk to people about them. but, you know, but anyway, thanks once again for joining us and tuning into the Raise by Rentals program. If you had fun with this, if you learned something, please let us know. Visit us on the socials. Drop us a line. Leave us a comment. Rate our podcast. Let us know what you think we should rant and rave about next time. And with that, I'm Josh.
I'm Mike.
And we have to return some videotapes.
Sorry.